P-Money says late. Yes, P-Money, I am late. I apologize. I didn't even have time to put the little two-minute timer in here to count down to the start of the live stream because I am just I'm just trying to run around and get stuff done, and I am really bad at live streaming. So, hello everybody. How you doing? Good seeing you. Let me run back and forth some more. For your entertainment. Jeff Potts says I'm late too. Yes, I know. In case you don't know, my name is Jason Robinson. I am an illustrator, a graphic artist, and this is my YouTube channel, Illustration by Design. And as you can tell, maybe, I am drawing Colossus from the X-Men right now. This is a commissioned drawing from one of the backers of the comic book I just finished, Secret Comics Presents. And several people bought original art from me, other character of their choice. And one person chose Colossus. And so I started him yesterday, and I'm going to finish him today. And so I'm going to be working on that. And I'm also going to, if I finish this, I'm going to start another one, probably P-Money's Power Girl, if I have time. I can only live stream for about 2 hours. This live stream will end at 4:30. So if there's time, I'll get started on Power Girl. But considering P Money's attitude, same, I was late. I may just take extra long working on this, so I don't get to his Power Girl artwork until maybe next week sometime. Maybe next month. Maybe I'll just forget it altogether. I don't know. It all depends on P Money's attitude. We'll see. We'll see. Right now, I'm trying to get it onto my phone so I can dag-nab it. Nah, there we go. All right. Yeah. Close that. Open this so I can see YouTube. And actually see comments. Jeff Potts says the chat is collectively, both of us, outraged. Yes, all two of you. There are actually four people in the chat now, which is pretty good. PMI says, I'm outraged until my Power Girl is in my hands. I don't know. It might not get in your hands. Doodle Squatch says, how do you make money if comic is secret? Well, we let the secret escape so that people had time to buy the comic book. And then once we closed the sales last month because we had to go to print, and so the secret is now a secret once again. So we made some money, but Pimai says that's okay. I'll just be in a constant state of outrage until then. Okay, that's fine. I'm sure Ruth will keep you in check. So, oh cool, five people are here. Okay, great. Well, actually, before I get started on finishing the drawing, I got a package in the mail today, which I'm going to unbox live and in person. Hopefully you guys can hear me, because I have a tendency to turn the mic off inadvertently. Anyway, I got this in the mail today. It's an eBay purchase, but I've been making a few eBay purchases the last several days for my birthday. My wife let me buy stuff for myself for my birthday, and this is one of my birthday presents to myself that I got on eBay. And so I'm going to open it up, and we'll see what's in it. Let me zoom out so I can actually see what's in here. Zoink! P-Money says, you got to do what's in the box intro. Do I have that? I don't know if I have that. Let me see. Let me see if I have a what's in the box intro. Is this it? I don't know.
Who's in the box?
What's in the box?
Not till you give me the
what's
gun.
In the box?
Okay, there you go. Hopefully that'll satisfy everybody. Especially P Money. All right, let's see what's in the box. Hopefully it's not Gwyneth Paltrow's head. That would be awkward because it's kind of flat. I would have had to squish her head quite a bit in order to fit it in this box. But, let me They got a lot of tape on here, which is good. B-Mai says, what did you bleep out? I have no idea. I'm afraid you're going to have to watch 7 for yourself and find out what was deleted. What was bleeped out? I have very sensitive ears, P-Money, so I can't allow such language to sully my virgin hearing. Alright, there we go. Ah, there we go. Cracked it. We cracked it. Oh yeah, there we go. Oh yeah. Ooh, it was in a Ziploc bag too. Now you know these people are true comic book fans because they store their comic books in Ziploc bags. Look at that. Only the top. A true comic book fan would have Ziploc bags protecting their comics. All right, let me move this out of the way. All right. This is why I ordered. It's Captain America's Bicentennial Battles. Let me open this up. This is a classic. Oops. There we go. Dang. Okay, there we go. This is a classic from 1976, the Bicentennial of the United States. And I'm a big fan of the Bicentennial because I was a kid back in 76. And it's one of my favorite memories is going to all the Bicentennial parades back then and seeing all these Old Glory flags like this one here. And, you know, just a very... There hasn't been that much patriotism during my lifetime in the United States, except for right after 9/11. You know, the Bicentennial and right after 9/11, when everybody got together, you know, to fight a common enemy, were the two times when there was so much pride in the USA that it was just awe-inspiring. And so I've always loved Bicentennial stuff, especially comic books, because comic books got into the whole thing, especially Captain America. And yeah, so this is one of the Treasury editions. I never got these when I was a kid. I saw them, but I never had one of my own. So this is one of the ones I saw as a kid and I always wanted. So I got this for my birthday. This one's for America's birthday. See, happy birthday, America. So I got it for my birthday as well. But this is all new stories. These aren't reprints. These are all new stories for this book by Jack Kirby, written by Jack Kirby, drawn by Jack Kirby. But it was inked by several different people, including Barry Windsor Smith, who inked this first story, which is very cool. And you can kind of tell because if you look at it, you can see a lot of the. Is there enough light in here? There we go. Not good. Hold on. Let me see if I can fix the lighting on this. Lighting. Let's see. That's a little better. It's a little too bright. Let's see here. Let me tone this down a little. That's better. You can kind of see Barry Windsor Smith's ink style, you know, in the faces, a lot of the detail work on these characters. You know, like I said, it's penciled by Jack Kirby, but the detailing kind of tells the tale of who inked it. So Barry Windsor Smith inked his first story, and then John Romita inked one of the stories, and also Herb Trimpe, the longtime artist for the Hulk, inked also other parts of the story. So I saw clips of this online. It just looks really, really cool. Captain America goes through time and deals with, you know, different things happening in America at different times, you know, slavery days. You know, he goes into the future of America. It's a pretty interesting story. So yeah, very exciting. Wow. Very, very neat stuff. So I am very excited about getting this book. And yeah, very awesome stuff. Man. So this is a classic comic that I am happy to add to my collection. And here's the back cover. Look at this. Look at this art. Congratulations, Sam. You're as young and fit as ever. There's Uncle Sam all happy. He's like, yay, I'm old. But this is America. God bless her. And then, yeah, this funky-looking bald eagle up here. Jack Kirby wasn't great at drawing birds, but he was the king. So you can't really – you can't complain about his work too much. I love Jack Kirby's work. You know, he has a very distinct goofy style. I shouldn't say goofy because it's a great style, but it's just you know, a lot of people think it's old fashioned. I love it though, just because it to me just speaks. It just says Marvel, classic Marvel comics, and so I love that stuff. I gotta take care of this and make sure that I don't damage it. So. But, yeah, just beautiful, to my mind. Beautiful artwork from Jack Kirby. But, anyway, that's my unboxing for this live stream. Let me put this aside. So it does not get damaged. Where can I put it? I'll put it here. For the time being, put it with the Ziploc bag. Where did I? Oh, there it is. There's a Ziploc bag. And bring back Colossus, with that aside, and then get to drawing. P-Money says, isn't Uncle Sam a DC comic character? He is, but they don't own the character of Uncle Sam. Uncle Sam is not owned by anyone. He's like Santa Claus, you know. You can make a comic book about Santa Claus, but that doesn't keep anyone else from making other comic books about Santa Claus because no one owns the rights to the character of Santa Claus. He's sort of like a generic fictional character, so they can do whatever they want. I wish I could play some music for you so you won't get bored by just me talking. I'm not the best. Sort of ad libber when it comes to live streaming and talking. I don't really speak extemporaneously. I think that's the word. That well, but yeah, my iPod died, and so I, or you rather, are stuck just listening to my voice rather than some cool music to distract you from the fact that I'm kind of boring. Hold on one second. Let me zoom in. And let me focus this so you can see what's going on. All right. We got that. And let's see. We've got four people left. One person ran off when they found out there was no music. I don't blame you. All you have to entertain you is my drawing and my babbling. All right, and let me move these pens to the side. Let me move this over. All right, there we go. Okay, I'm gonna get going or continuing on this Colossus. And PY says, you mean without music we have to talk to you? Yeah, or talk amongst yourselves. Which will probably be more entertaining for you. Like I said, I'm kind of boring. I don't really have much to say. I'm just, I just draw. So, but if you guys have any topics you'd like to discuss, I'm happy to talk to you about them. I just don't really have any topics off the top of my head. I haven't seen the new What If, so I don't know what it's about. I don't really know what's really going on. Really anywhere in terms of pop culture or anything. What's going on with the... like I said yesterday, I haven't seen Shang-Chi. I don't really know of any movies, good movies, that are coming out anytime soon. I mean, I guess Spider-Man's coming out. What's it coming out? It's coming out in December, I think. Eternals is coming out at some point, and I'm have no zero interest in seeing that. It looks like garbage. Taking a great Jack Kirby creation and just making it into sort of generic, diversity pablum, where they race and sex swap half the characters. Trash. I'm not watching that. P-Mai says, I'm not. Jeff Potts says, I have no intention of watching Shang-Chi. Well, let me say two things. One, Shang-Chi looks like garbage to me, because to me, a good comic book movie is a comic book movie that respects the source material. And Shang-Chi the movie looks very little like Shang-Chi Master of Kung Fu. You know, they took a character that is pretty much solely a martial arts character, and they've turned him into a Wuxia, fantasy Pokemon hero, where he's fighting dragons and Pokemon and weird little CGI characters. I mean, it looks like 90% CGI, 10% martial arts. And to my mind, that's not what a Shang-Chi movie should be. It should be 90% martial arts. It should be like just one guy just kicking people's butts left and right with Kung Fu. And it should be a lot more like the Ip Man movies than it should be looking like, Space Jam, which this movie looks like. So I have no interest in paying money to see Shang-Chi, but I am considering using one of my many gift cards, which have been gathering dust since the pandemic for the last 2 years. I have about $100 worth of gift cards that I can use for the movies that I have not used because I haven't been to the movies. And I might go see Shang-Chi with them. I don't know. Maybe. But I will not pay money for it. I'll spend other people's money from the gift cards they gave me, but I will not use my own. Let's see. P-Mai says, I'm not enjoying What If at all. Why aren't you enjoying What If? I've enjoyed two of them. I enjoyed the Doctor Strange one, and I liked the one with the Avengers dying. So the other one, one with Sharon Carter, I thought was sort of woke nonsense. And I didn't watch the one with Black Panther because I was afraid if I watched it, it'd just make me angry because the premise, I don't know. I might be prejudging it incorrectly, but the whole premise with Star-Lord being kidnapped was that his father was Ego the Living Planet in the movie. So if they change it so that T'Challa's father is Ego the Living Planet, that kind of, it doesn't make any sense to me, because how then can he be the king of Wakanda if his father is not the king of Wakanda? So I didn't watch it just because I was afraid I'd be disappointed and annoyed from the very premise of the show. But I might be wrong. I don't know. Jeff Potts says, The Eternals looks lame. It looks very lame. It looks very boring. It looks very stupid. And like I said, they completely race and sex swapped most of the characters in the film. So I have no interest in seeing it. You know, and they're not wearing any of their costumes, any of their classic costumes, or at least most of them aren't. So, they're unrecognizable from the characters they're playing. And I loved the Eternals when I was growing up. I mean, it's one of my favorite comics as a kid. But they kind of ruined it. What If is a chance to really dive into the comics, but they keep focusing on the movies, and that's just not interesting to me. Well, the problem is that most of the people watching on most of the public know nothing about Marvel Comics. They only know the MCU because they never read the comics, or if they read the comics, they've forgotten 99% of what they read back when they were kids. So they're going to make What If about what they know the public is familiar with, which is the movies and the TV shows. So yeah, you're not gonna have any, you know, what ifs about old Aunt May becoming Galactus's herald. That's not gonna happen. So you might have one about young hot Aunt May. You know, what if young hot Aunt May I don't know, found the Green Lantern ring. I don't know, whatever they do. It will be based on the Marvel comics. I started watching the one with the Marvel zombies, and again, it annoyed me because, you know, that Spider-Man running around without his mask 90% of the time. It's like, he wears a mask for, it's so annoying. Why even put him in a costume if he's not going to be wearing his mask? It's stupid. Sorry. Need some water. I'm talking too much. If you haven't already, please like this video. Please give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel if you have not done so to this point. Also, make sure to hit the bell for notifications of future videos, and please make sure to set the notification bell for all notifications. Otherwise, you won't be notified whenever I live stream or post a video. Artist Resource says, hey, great skills you got there. Thank you very much. Hopefully you're not talking about my speaking skills, because my speaking skills stink. So that's why I draw instead. Let's see. Artist Resource says, I'm Leona. How's it going, Jason? I've subbed. Thank you very much, Leona. I really appreciate it. I hope you enjoy the live stream. And hopefully I don't bore you with my rambling too much. P-Mai says, I see fans coming up with better what-if ideas, like what if the other half got snapped? Ah, that'd be cool. That would be interesting. I would be interested in seeing that. So, but I don't even know what yesterday's what-if was. I didn't see it. I'll probably check it out later on. P Money is trying to sell my work to Leona. Thank you very much, P Money. Oh, and in case some of you don't know, the comic that I drew, Secret Comics Presents, is now being mailed out to everybody. You may have already known, but I'm just repeating it for people who don't know. Nasser Rabadi is mailing out the book as we speak. And so you should be getting your copies in the next week or so. So have no fear, except for the people that I'm doing these drawings for. You will have to wait a little longer, because your drawings will be going inside of your Gemini mailers. So you will be people who I'm doing commissions for right now, like whoever ordered this Colossus, you will be getting your artwork a little later than the rest of everybody else. But you will all receive your artwork by early October. I'm going to finish these commissions this week and then mail them to Nasser next week. So you should be getting your stuff very shortly. Artist Resource says, how long have you been streaming here on YouTube, Jason? I've been streaming on YouTube for about 3 years now. Consistently, probably the last 2 years. It's just been, YouTube is an extrovert's paradise, and I am not an extrovert, so I live stream, but I do it reluctantly. So there are stretches where I won't live stream for like weeks on end, or I won't post videos for weeks on end, and then I come back once I gather up the nerve. So or when I have to promote something like Secret Comics Presents, a comic book that I was drawing, then I was live streaming almost every day, or at least several times a week. because, you know, I need to get the word out and stuff. But yeah, I've been on YouTube for about 3 years now. But unfortunately, because you know, you have to be very consistent with YouTube, and so my channel really hasn't grown that much, you know, in 3 years. I only have about 800 subscribers, which is great, but you know, yep, you'll have YouTube channels that, like, you know, blow past 1,000 subs in like a week just because, you know, they're very engaging, and also, you know, they're very consistent about putting out stuff. P-Money says, not to mention international customers taking forever to get it. Yeah, that's unfortunate. So P-Money lives in Canada, so he probably won't be getting his book until around Christmas, if he's lucky. And Leona says, well, enjoy and keep up the good work. Thank you very much. And thanks for hanging out. I appreciate it. Hope to see you again, Leona. You take care. She says she can't stay, just flying by. Stay creative. I will do my best. That was cool. It's cool that Leona stopped by to say hello. Ah, I'm hitting my head against the camera again. It's always tough for me to try to figure out how to do the reflections on Colossus's armor. I mean, I kind of have a pretty good idea of how to do it, but I said it's been a while since I drew him, so I'm trying to remember everything. Hey, Improbi, how you doing? Good seeing you. Jeff Bryce says, like P-Money, Mike Miller was my gateway drug as well. Oh, to meeting me. Yeah. Once you've gone black, you never go back. So you're stuck. You're trapped. but yeah, Mike is a really cool creator. Pretty nice guy. So I missed drawing a quarter yesterday, unfortunately. I saw that he was drawing his monkey, his like NFT monkey. I have no idea what that's about. Did any of you guys watch it? Do you know what I don't know what that character is. Is that a comic book that Mike is creating, another NFT comic book, or what? It's like Mike creates like a lot of content, but it's like, it's just frustrating because it's like I never get to see any of it come to sort of fruition. It's like, I think I'm still waiting on like 3 comic books that he did that he's drawn, but still has not been printed. I'm like, when is it coming out? P-Money says, I saw a new Star Wars trailer for Star Wars Andor, and I'm actually interested since I liked Rogue One. Is that an actual movie or is it a video game? I'm not familiar with it. And probably says, I was watching the first part of your Noster masterpiece. Luckily, I decided to check what live streams were going on. Okay, good. Well, I'm glad you saw that I was live streaming again. Actually, let me me try something. Oh, P-Mice says, Jeff Pine says, I don't quite understand the NFT thing either, but whatever keeps his bills paid. That's the thing. It's like, is it paying his bill? I don't know. I mean, that's what I'm saying. It's like, how does he make money from it? Are these things that people are buying? I don't know. Because again, it doesn't make sense to me. You know, if people are buying these NFTs, this digital artwork is one of kind things. That's cool. That's awesome. But are they? I don't know. As Mike told us that these are selling. I don't know. I hope they are, because I would hate to see him waste his time and talent on things that he hopes pays off at some point in the future instead of just making books that I would buy as soon as he puts them out, you know. The buy with crypto. What does that mean? I don't know. I don't know what that means. I'll be right back. I gotta do one thing. I'm not leaving a room. I gotta go to my computer to do something. Hold on. Still here. I haven't left. I haven't died. I haven't slipped and fallen. Broken my skull. It's up to. Let's see. See, it's at times like this that I wish I had some music to sort of fill in the blanks instead of me having to sort of ramble so there's no dead space. Please hold, I'll be right back. Let me see here. I try one more thing. All right, there we go. Ah, boy. Oh, wow. 5 people showed up. Another person's here. Very exciting. Yeah, I just dropped a link to the live stream to a few people, so maybe some people will show up. If not, then that's fine too. I will keep on drawing. P-Money says, yeah, I bought a little Bitcoin just to be in the game, but I'm not using crypto to buy comic art. Yeah, the only crypto I have is they were offering, I think it was Coinbase, was offering $5 in free crypto, free Bitcoin if you signed up. And so I like free stuff, so I signed up with Coinbase. But I haven't actually put any of my own money into crypto. But it's increased in price. I think it's worth like $7 now from the original $5.
Yay! I've made money.
Let's see. Oh, Jeff Potts says, then they buy the NFTs with crypto. And Mike has sort of intimated that taking some of the earnings from MAGA 7 and pouring that into crypto has paid serious dividends. P Money says, Jeff Potts, I treat my Bitcoin like I do my stocks and my mutual funds investing for the future, but I don't use my mutual funds to buy comics. And, oops, hold on. I think I heard something. Oh. Hello.
Well, hello there.
Hey, hold on one second. You're very loud.
You're loud. Your mama's loud.
Shut up. My mama will kick your butt. She actually would.
She probably would. She probably wears combat boots, too.
Yeah. Yeah, she's pretty scary, so try to stay on her good side. How you doing, John?
I'm doing pretty good, I guess. I don't know. Why? What's it to you?
I'm just asking. There you go. Make you small so people can see my beautiful art.
Make you feel like a big man to make me small, Jim?
Yeah, it does, basically. keep baby in the corner. Yeah, I just wanted to give you an opportunity to come in here and say hello to everybody. Lady Celtic Moon is here. She was just watching Aaron Lopresti. So,
who's that?
Who's Aaron Lopresti? Some hack. Nah. But yeah, I can't wait to get his book. It looks really good. Very excited about that. How long are you going to keep the buckler up in demand?
Until fulfillment ends.
So you're fulfilling it right now?
No, not yet.
Okay.
How do you draw a guy with long hair? Uh-huh. He's a Native American fellow, right?
Yeah.
He has long, luscious, beautiful Indian hair.
Right.
But I have him. He's giving resuscitation, right? Mm-hmm. But I want to show his face, but he has long hair that's not tied up.
Have it over one shoulder. Have him brush it aside so you can see his face. So the side of his face that's facing the viewer, you can see, and the hair is going over the other side. Does that make sense?
No.
Oh, gosh. All right. Let me do a quick drawing for you.
Don't do that.
I have to, John.
Don't do it.
You don't understand my words, so I'll have to draw you a picture. Do you want me to or no?
No, not at all.
Okay. Cool. Then I'll do it.
Oh, Jesus. Okay.
You got Native American man here. Actually, let me.
I can't see. That's too light.
I know it's too light. Hold on. Dag nabbit.
Damn it, Jim.
I should have asked Nasser in here instead. All right. Here's scrap paper.
Don't pretend like you didn't send the link to Nasser. He just didn't show up.
Shut up. All right. You got dead person or whatever, whoever's knocked out here.
Yes.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
There, you can see that?
Oh, they're no. Out.
They're knocked out. And then you got Native American man or whatever his face is. You have him here.
Complete profile. Complete side profile.
So you want this to be a profile shot?
Yeah.
You don't?
It's not exactly profile. I have it like maybe a couple of degrees off, just so I can show one, like both eyes, but one eye barely, you know?
Okay. Well,
it's not like 3/4. It's barely okay. Not a profile.
How I would do it is like, I would have him here, Native American man here, you know, he's looking down, you know, doing mouth to mouth, whatever he's doing, you know, so his eyes are maybe open, but you can't see him.
Okay, what you're drawing here is the exact opposite. The Native American man is in profile. The person on the floor, you can kind of see their face. Take the angle how they're laying and flip it 90 degrees.
So he's in profile like this, like that?
Yes. That's a racist caricature of a Native American nose, Jim. And you know that. Oh, well.
Sue me. and then the person he's resuscitating is down here like this?
Mm-hmm.
Like that?
Yeah.
It looks like he's kissing them, not that he's resuscitating them.
Well, you drew the person on the bottom wrong. All you see is the top of their head.
Okay, the top of their head is here.
Yes.
Okay. So top of the head is facing the viewer. And then her eyes are down here.
There's a line down the middle. Yes, that's the hairline. Yeah.
Got exactly. It. Okay. Got it. Oh, my God.
But he has long, luscious hair.
You're so difficult, John. All right. Here we go. Got Native American man.
Look, I'm working off of somebody else's thumbnail. Okay. I'm not making up these angles on myself.
Okay. That's fine. And he's resuscitating someone who's like this. You got him here, and he's like this, like that. You know, he's like, rah, 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 rah. Their head is, I guess, over here, like this, and their ears are here. I don't know, whatever.
Oh my God. Look at my screen, okay? Just look at my screen.
Looking at your screen here.
Okay, look at my screen. I'm going to share real quick, okay? Just so you can see what I'm talking about here.
Let's see what weirdness you're doing, John.
Okay, so here's the guy's face, right?
Hold on, let me share. Add stream. Bam. There you go.
Okay, so here's the guy's face. Now, I already did the scene where he did the resuscitation, right? So what he's a little bit above. So the head of the person is down here.
Right.
This is their nose.
Yeah.
This is the hairline.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's how it's working there. Now I need to draw his hair. He has long hair that would be like this, covering up his entire face.
Yeah, but brush that hair to the other side.
Well, that's what I'm trying to. But the thing is, like, you know, I'm here's the ear right here, you know.
Right. Yeah.
I have a little bit tucked up behind the ear, but I don't. There would still be more hair here.
No.
Or do I just take artistic license and not do the hair there?
It's a drawing. Don't worry about it. Just have him brush the bulk of that hair to the other side so it's falling on that dead guy's neck. You understand?
Yeah, I get it. Yeah. Over here, had all the hair being pushed this way. Yeah,
like that. There you go. Or over his shoulder. Or over you know, the Indian guy's shoulder. So you don't even have to worry about it.
All right, whatever.
See?
No help at all.
Oh, please. You got it. Look at that.
I'm stopping sharing. You don't deserve it.
Huh. That Indian guy's nose was completely wrong. Huh. Wasn't stereotypical at all. No one's going to know that guy's Indian. Ridiculous.
His nose isn't anywhere near big enough.
It's not nearly aquiline enough, John.
Damn it. I mean, I thought that might be a problem when I took the single feather off the back of his head, you know.
Mm-hmm. Seriously. You give a guy a tomahawk at least? Come on. Terrible. It's terrible, John. Terrible.
What are you drawing?
What do you mean, what am I drawing? I'm drawing Colossus.
The Colossus of Clout?
What?
The Great Bambino.
Let's see. P-Money says, yay, Dillard.
Yay, P-Money.
Huh, interesting. The chat has completely died.
I'm sorry.
Thanks, John. You drove everyone away. There's only 3 people left. That's okay.
That's because we're not live anymore. You did something.
Oh, no. It killed the stream. So how much more do you have to do with the buckler?
8 pages of lettering.
Okay, cool. Very good. So what are you drawing now? What with the Indian stuff?
Oh, this is I have a friend. Goes by the name of Richard Charles John Piper.
I was like, oh, okay. I realized, oh, Piper, oh, Rick, hey.
Well, I have some pages out right now. They're getting edited. So I got some time to wait. So I told Rick that I would draw a book for him.
Oh, wow. Dang.
I told him I would give him a very reasonable price. I'm charging him $40 a page.
Wow. That's all, those are almost Nostra prices.
What?
That's almost close to why I charge Nostra.
Oh. Oh, no. I charge Nostra up the ass.
No, yeah. You're smart. I give him rock bottom prices.
But I told him, I was like, look, this is how it's going to work out here, Rick. Okay. It's not going to be my best work.
Right.
It's going to be super fast, quick and dirty. It's going to be competent. It's going to look like a regular average Joe comic.
Right.
I'll show you a page. Let me share again here.
Okay.
Window Clip Studio.
My computer.
Let me just pull up the previous page.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, so page 7. Let's see if that works out. Oh no, that's not working out. File open. Because I'm doing these very fast. Like, I'm doing about 3 pages a day for him.
Yeah.
So,
oh, wow. 3 pages a day. Dang.
Yeah. But they're like this, right?
Yeah.
So here's the thing is, this girl is frozen solid. So she's in this crawling position.
Oh, sheesh.
So when he puts her on the floor, she like racks. She like rocks back and forth like a rock, right? Oh. But he's putting her on a rug and next to a fireplace. And here he's lighting a fire. It's a top-down view. Next one, it shows her hand, the water's kind of melting on her hand.
Right.
And then, she closes a fist and then he listens because he can hear some breath. Right.
Yeah.
He's like, wait a minute, what? But she's not really. So he gives her some sweet, sweet mouth to mouth.
Right. Indian loving.
Mm-hmm. So a page like this is kind of like what I would do real fast. You know, I do a real quick under sketch. Like this is my under sketch here. If I take it away,
right?
Like this is about how I do it,
right?
Let me make this darker so you can see. So that this is my, and I work straight to inks from the thumbnails from these.
Wow.
So you know, it's real fast. I told him, you know, it's not gonna be my best work, but I'll get it done.
Cool.
And I'll do it real cheap.
Awesome. I'm sure.
And I'll do it when I can. I can't, you know, I can't commit. If I have higher paid work, I can't like push that aside, you know.
All right, yeah, of course. So, what book is this for? Is this for Canadian Shield?
No, this is his second hero that he wants to introduce. Because his first book, of course, was the Canadian Shield, and he's working currently on the Canadian Shield book 2.
Okay.
But this is the second one of his. You know, he has 7 premier characters.
Okay.
The second book is called Snowdrift. It's a lady that has. It's a lady. She's essentially Iceman, but a lady.
Okay. Got it. So is this her?
Yes.
Okay. Got it. Is this how she got her powers, by being frozen in the outside?
No, she got her powers from a magical kiss. Of course, this is how she got her powers, Jiminy.
I don't know. I'm asking.
Yeah, she got, well, all of their powers come from, the Lord.
Right. Yeah.
So none of his characters actually have like hard and fast, you know,
reasons. Not that it makes logical reason, but
right.
You know, they're all sort of wholly, you know, wholly empowered by God.
Yes.
Got it. Okay.
So she was kind of rescued by God, preserved for 50 years in the snow.
Oh, okay. Wow.
She was a scientist. One of the first women scientists way back in the late 1940s.
Okay.
They got to lead an expedition to the Canadian Arctic.
Mm-hmm.
However, one day she was out and a, you know, un forecasted storm came in and she was trapped out in wild, and God encased her in ice and preserved her. And when she was awakened, she had powers. She was able to turn things very cold into ice.
See, they should have done that with Captain America too, but they didn't. You know, the guy spent 50 years in ice. He just comes out, you know, normal. But that's cool. Awesome. How many pages is this going to be?
I think it's 20.
Okay.
Two to 24.
Okay. So just normal.
You know, his books, it's a normal floppy. You know, his books are his first book, his introductory books anyway, they're all kind of like intro books. They're like just exposition dumps.
Right.
Kind of like, this is how, you know, miles away, you know, a planet Krypton is dying. They send a single son, you know, that kind of deal.
Yeah.
That's what these books are. They're like intros to his characters.
Cool.
And at the very ends, like the last, like, I don't know, 7 or 8 pages, there's like a small event where they get to use their powers.
So, he's got 7 characters. Are they going to team up and form a group at some point?
Do you know? Yes, they are.
Okay. What are they going to be called? Do you know?
The Holy Warriors.
Okay. Cool.
No, it isn't. That's the lamest name I ever heard. I keep telling him.
Well, I don't. Is that what he's calling them?
Yes.
Okay. They're his characters. I mean, what am I going to say? You know?
Tell him their name. Tell him change the name.
Oh, gosh.
Put him on a bus. Call him the Holy Rollers.
Oh, man. That's cool. It's cool you're helping him out. You're doing some good work for him.
But, you know, it's satisfactory. It's adequate. The figures are there. The perspective is correct.
Yeah.
You know, nothing's crazy. It's a very passable, readable type of style, you know?
Yeah, I gotcha. Where is... oh, there it is. Sorry, I'm looking at my...
You're not paying attention to your guest, John Dillard.
I'm paying attention to your guest. I was trying to pay attention to the chat, though. I thought my
chat... Ain't nobody talking in the chat.
Yeah, I noticed. No, everyone's gone. Everybody disappeared. Everybody's silent. So, have you been watching that Marvel series, What If?
No.
No? Okay.
I don't like that style of animation, and I definitely...
I don't either, but I'm a nerd, so I have to watch it. I do hate computer cell animation, though. I find it very stiff and not fun to watch.
Well, the thing is, they're used. It's very inappropriate, the use of it. They're using it, and they're making the... Because I have seen a couple of clips from a trailer. And they're using like that Marvel style humor.
Right.
But in a cartoon, it's like, no, this is the kind of humor you use on a live sitcom, not at all for an animated show. You know, it's stupid. What? And they do, and the thing is, because of the cell animation, and because the timing is so bad on it, like the jokes don't land. They never do.
Yeah. No, I agree.
So it's frustrating to even look at. So I don't know. I'm not going to put myself through that to watch it.
Through the misery. A couple of them have been good, though. They read like Twilight Zone episodes, and I like that about the about 2 of them out of the... I think they've come out with 6 so far. So I don't know. Some of them have just sort of landed flat for me, but you know, it's decent. I've seen far worse on the CW. So
yeah, I don't subject myself to the CW.
Yeah, I stopped watching it pretty much altogether. I think 2 years ago, I just could not take it anymore. I can only tolerate so much garbage in my superhero viewing.
That sounds to me like you can tolerate quite a bit.
I can tolerate quite a bit, John. I'm a pretty a pretty pathetic nerd. If it has superheroes in it, there's a 95%, 99.9% chance I will watch it. And if it's bad, there's about a 75% chance I'll keep watching it. Just because.
Man.
I don't know. I like superheroes so much that I'm willing to put up with a lot. So, but the CW managed to break me after about 9 years of watching it. Or no, it started like 2013. So I would say probably about 6 years. 6 years of watching the CW finally broke me, and I couldn't take it anymore. And I was like, and that's enough. Even I can no longer tolerate your garbage. So, but,
I don't know. You're the kind of guy that likes to punish himself. I don't know.
Yeah, I am I'm a comic book masochist. I am willing to suffer quite a bit of pain. But you know, like the Marvel movies, they finally broke me after about a decade, and seeing them get progressively worse. I'm not watching any of these new movies. At least not spending any money on them. So,
I can understand that. I like the Marvel. I feel like the Marvel movies came in just under the wire and did a good job wrapping themselves up before it got too bad.
I'm sorry.
I said before it got too bad. I feel they did a good job wrapping up their story.
Oh yeah. I mean the whole Thanos saga. I mean, it ended okay, but you know, even that one. I mean, I really liked Infinity War, Endgame. I tolerated it, but it was just there's so much stupid stuff in it. It was just I was like, okay, this is it, and then as they were announcing like the new movies coming up, I realized like, okay, they just don't really care about the
about right, these movies, right.
You know, so. Mm-hmm. I'm just not going to watch any of them.
Good for you.
Yeah.
I mean, and here's the thing. I realize it's a little bit hard for me to understand.
Mm-hmm.
Because you do subject yourself to shows like the CW. I don't see how you can just nope out of actual movies that have good parts in them and good action scenes when you watch things like the CW.
Right. But CW is for free. You know, you don't pay money for that.
I mean, I already have like Netflix accounts and Disney accounts and stuff. So most of these things for me are free anyway, essentially.
Jeff Potts says 6 years. I was done with the CW after 6 minutes. See, Jeff Potts has a much lower tolerance for nonsense than I do.
It seems to me to be, like counterintuitive that you would nope out of movies that are actually, you know, have big budget battle scenes and stuff and cool image, even if it's not your Marvel,
right?
You know,
yeah.
It still
yeah.
has, you know, decent aspects,
yeah.
And then be like, oh, I'm gonna watch Batgirl, I'm gonna watch The Flash, I'm gonna watch Arrow, I'm gonna watch Iron Fist.
Well, I don't watch any of them. That's my point. It's like I put up with them for a long time, and even like Iron Fist, I didn't even get through the first season. It was so bad. It was so. I mean, that was painfully bad. Again, you know, if I can watch anything for free, I'm willing to tolerate it a fair amount more than I would something where I have to go to the movies and pay money and spend 2 hours watching it as opposed to like half an hour or an hour. Mm-hmm. Like I said, both the CW and the Marvel films, you know, going forward, it's like I have no interest in them. You know, if they're going to change characters, if they're going to change, you know, sort of storyline so much that they're almost unrecognizable. And I mean, like the Spider-Man movies, I never liked them. The new ones, I felt that the MCU Spider-Man was just like a lame sidekick who didn't have his own sort of personality. You know, he's dependent on other heroes to sort of give him a reason to sort of do things. And, you know, I have no interest in watching a character like that. I want to see a Spider-Man that, you know, sort of is independent, you know, is smart on his own, isn't depending on other people's, you know, billion-dollar companies to have him, you know, beat his enemies and stuff. It's kind of, I don't know. That's just me, though. A lot of people like him, but I can't get into it.
Why?
Why what?
Why can't you get into it?
Because it's not Spider-Man. it's like watching like Spider, you know, or what they call him, Iron Kid. You know, he's a sidekick. He's an Iron Man simp. Huh?
Iron Lad.
Yeah, he's like an Iron Man simp. It's like he doesn't have his own personality. That doesn't interest me. So.
But Batgirl does.
Batgirl?
But Iron Fist interests you.
What? What? Oh, man.
Because the thing is, like, yeah, I can get behind this is the Spider-Man in the MCU. It's right. Not the Spider-Man, because the Spider-Man that I know and I like is the Spider-Man from the 90s cartoon.
Right.
Okay, that was my introduction to Spider-Man. My first introduction to Spider-Man was not from the comics.
Okay.
It was from the cartoon. And okay. let me find out, because there's been a couple of Spider-Man cartoons. Let me find
Spider-Man out. Spider-Man has Amazing Friends, the 1960s Spider-Man, which was the best Spider-Man.
Right, I've seen that. That's hot garbage, so you're wrong on that.
Best, oh, come on. See, now I know you're full of nonsense, full of crap. If you don't like the 1960 Spider-Man cartoon, you might as well just.
Yeah, super bad cartoon.
Be ignored.
Complete waste of time. Yeah, it's called Spider-Man the Animated Series. That's the one that I liked.
Okay, yeah. You ever watch Spider-Man and His Amazing Friends? That was a
yes, I have. I just told you. It was terrible.
No, not. That's the 1980s one. I'm talking about the 1960s one. Remember the cartoon from the 1960s?
Let me look. No, I wasn't alive in the 1960s, Jim.
I know. They had it in reruns. I wasn't alive either. It was one of the theme songs, Spider-Man. Spider-Man does whatever a Spider-Man
does. Oh, yes. I've seen that. It's a terrible cartoon.
That's a great cartoon. Oh, my gosh, John.
So, you know, when Spider-Man, Sam Raimi's Spider-Man came out, I was like, oh, that's not the Spider-Man from the cartoon. But I still liked it.
Yeah, I liked it a fair amount. Spider-Man 2 was good. Spider-Man 3 was garbage. And Spider-Man.
And that's the thing, because I, you know, when I grew up in the 90s, you know, because I was born in 84, so I basically grew up in the 90s.
Okay, so you're a kid. Yeah.
You know, when I was out, I was a kid, and I was like, this is a great cartoon.
You didn't know any better. Okay, I understand.
Yeah, I know better now, so I know to stay away from the 60s Spider-Man.
Yeah, but you still have the taste that you did back when you were 6 years old, so you still like kind of bad stuff.
No, Jim. Bad is bad. So I'm like, okay, so I like the Spider-Man. I didn't like the Green Goblin. I thought he was kind of hokey.
Uh-huh.
Way too hokey for a live-action film.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. He'd look like a Power Ranger.
Yeah. I was like, he would look better in, like, a cloth costume.
Yeah, if you ever have a chance, you should go on YouTube and look up the original costume design they had for the Green Goblin in that Sam Raimi movie. Really, really, really cool. I have no idea who convinced them to drop that. What they did, they had a completely sort of animatronic head mask that actually fit on an actor so that the actor's expressions were reflected in the head's expressions. It was so cool. I wish I could. Can I show something on?
Well, I can if you want me to.
Yeah, I don't know.
Just share what I'm sharing.
What are you sharing? I don't see anything on
God damn it. I'm telling you to do that so you can come back to your, you can come back. Okay, so there we go. Here's the original concept for the
Sam Raimi. That's it. There you go. But They should have used that. And they have like video showing him moving and everything. Can you pop that up?
I can try. Let's see if I can find it.
Videos? There you go. Get Shang-Chi out of here. No one wants to see him. Put the volume on. See the volume. John.
No, there is no volume on here.
Just click right there where it says mute.
I didn't click to share volume anyway. It doesn't matter.
Oh, gosh. It's terrible.
Can you hear it now?
There we go. I mean, look at, oh my gosh. How could they not use that? Oh, terrible. That was the worst decision they made with that movie. Not using that those prosthetics for the film. Mm-hmm. You still there?
Yeah.
Okay. You were silent.
Yeah, it looks great.
John Doerr was stunned by the beauty of those animatronics for Spider-Man.
So I wasn't a big fan of the Green Goblin part. I did like the Spider-Man aspect of it.
Yeah.
It was kind of weird that he had spider webs coming out of his body, and I was like, yeah. It wasn't great. But the thing was, overall, I enjoyed the movie, and I enjoyed rewatching the movie.
Yeah, me too. I agree.
Even though it wasn't my Spider-Man.
Yeah, but he was recognizable as Spider-Man, and he acted 75% like Spider-Man. So to me, that satisfied me. With the Tom Holland Spider-Man, he doesn't act like Spider-Man. He wears the costume, but you know, it's like he doesn't solve his own problems. Other people have to solve the problems for him. He's not his own hero. He's a sidekick in his own movies.
Did you watch Spider-Man the first one, the Tom Holland first movie?
First one, second one, this new one, you know? He's always dependent on some other hero to solve his problems for him. The first movie, Tony Stark. Second movie, it was Nick Fury or the Skrull who dressed up like Nick Fury.
Well, let's take the first movie, right?
Yeah.
The one where Tony Stark comes in and tells him, you know, be your own person, solve your own problems,
right?
That kind of thing.
Yep.
That's not out of the box for Spider-Man. Spider-Man, he will commonly defer to the knowledge of other people.
I understand
and
that.
And then come up with the solution at the very end. Tony Stark was not in the end of the movie, in the last battle.
In the last battle, the only reason Spider-Man found the strength to get underneath that building that collapsed on him was because he was inspired by Tony Stark's words. If Tony Stark's words hadn't said those words to him, he'd still be buried underneath that building. As opposed to in the comics, when the same situation happened to him, he thought back to the words of Uncle Ben.
Well, God forbid you think for, you know, Uncle Ben. I mean, if it wasn't for Uncle Ben, Spider-Man would be nobody. I mean, what kind of a simp would Spider-Man be if not for Uncle Ben?
The whole reason why Spider-Man does what he does is because of the memory of Uncle Ben, and Uncle Ben teaching him right from wrong. They completely tossed out Uncle Ben in the MCU. He's not even a factor. They never even mentioned his name. And he, in 5 years of Spider-Man being in the MCU, he's a complete non-entity. The only thing that inspires Spider-Man now is Tony Stark. whether it's Tony Stark himself, Tony Stark's memories, or Tony Stark's money. That's the only thing that gets Spider-Man through any of his movies. In his last movie, Far From Home, he had Tony Stark, well, not he was dead, but Tony Stark's super jet flown by Happy had to fly in and fly Spider-Man from Holland all the way to London. If you take Tony Stark out of Spider-Man's story in the MCU, there is no Spider-Man. That's my whole point. He's completely dependent.
Well, that's a terrible point.
Huh?
That's a terrible point.
It's not a terrible point. He's not Spider-Man. He's Tony Stark's simp. That's all he is.
He's a different kind of Spider-Man.
He's lame. It's like, that's what I'm saying. It's like,
now
it's
that's not a point. That's a point that you can make, is that it's lame.
Well, he is. That's why I don't like his movies. I don't like watching his movies because he's not Spider-Man to me. Spider-Man is not a character that is completely dependent on Tony Stark.
Well, he's not completely. God damn it. You keep going to that same argument. It's not true.
But take Tony Stark out of the MCU. Who is what? Where does Spider-Man?
And you have no MCU if you take Tony Stark out of the MCU.
that's true. Okay, take Tony Stark. Okay, take Tony Stark out of Spider-Man's story in the MCU.
Like, take Spider-Man? Reed Richards out of the Fantastic Four, and what do you have? get rid of Charles Xavier out of the X-Men, and then what do you have? Just a bunch of no goodniks running around.
Yeah, a bunch of losers running around, getting chased by people with pitchforks.
I'm just saying it's I mean I don't find anything, I guess, because, and I'm gonna say this, I guess because I don't live and breathe and die by these characters.
That's your loss.
Right. I don't really care when they get changed at all.
I understand.
I don't know. But even some things that I was super into, I still, like, you know how many times and abominations and different kinds of terrible things have happened to the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles?
Oh, heck.
Ninja Turtles. Like, but I don't, I'm not like, ooh, I hate the new Ninja. I don't. I'll watch a new Ninja Turtle movie. I don't care if they change it a lot. You know, it's not that big of a deal to me if they change something.
Yeah, but I don't know. Ninja Turtles, eh. Mm.
Because that was something that I was like very, because I'm trying to think of something I was super into. Like, okay, also, I was a little bit, you know, younger than you. I didn't watch He-Man.
He-Man, yeah.
I watched Thundercats.
Oh yeah, Thundercats, they're the best.
And they've done some awful things to Thundercats, but I'm not like all bent out of shape about it.
Yeah, but I don't watch them though. That's what I'm saying. It's like whether it's Thundercats or He-Man or the new Spider-Man movies. If they change them to a point where they're just not the characters anymore, I just won't watch them. That's my point. It's like even I mean, as a comic book nerd, someone who will watch almost anything, Marvel has pushed me to the point where I cannot watch their stuff because it's so far removed from the characters that they're based on. That
it's far from home.
To me, they're unwatchable. You know, and I'm someone who would watch the CW stuff, you know, for 6 years.
Yeah, you're awful.
Marvel was able to beat that, you know, and kill my interest in only three. So, good job, Marvel. But I am looking forward to the new James Bond movie. Despite all the changes they make with that character. So...
Hey, you sound like a hypocrite.
I probably am, but I think it's also because I'm not as heavily invested in James Bond as I am with comic book characters. So I'm like, okay, cool. And plus, they've been changing James Bond for the entire run of his movies, so I'm just used to it. You know,
they've been changing Spider-Man for the entire run of his movies.
Yeah, but James Bond's been around for what, 50 years now? 60. 60 years.
You and all your excuses.
I'm just saying, there's a reason. There's a reason why.
Just admit that you're a filthy hypocrite.
I am a filthy hypocrite, but there's a reason why. Dealing with the character that's been around for, you know, 30 years is it, and I just, and also the source material for the Spider-Man is still ongoing. You know, the James Bond books, I mean, are they still making them? I don't think they are.
I don't think so. But okay, like for instance, there was a part that was very un-James Bond, right?
Oh yeah, a lot of them are very un-James Bond. But go ahead.
Okay, so there was a James Bond movie.
Yeah.
Called Skyfall.
Oh yeah, I love that movie.
You can't love that movie because it's not James Bond, Jimmy.
It is James Bond. Go ahead, make your argument. Okay,
so in this film, and one of the leaving.
You chased him away. Thanks a lot, John.
Jeff Potts, get back here.
He's going to get soda.
Okay, but hurry back. So, in this film, yeah, there's a sequence in the beginning of the film,
yeah,
where James Bond is chasing down this guy that killed an agent.
Yeah, I remember that.
Right, and in this sequence, James Bond gets on a backhoe.
No, yeah,
and he because the guy uses a super powered Uzi to kind of decouple the trains from each other.
Right. Yeah.
And so James Bond, in order to not, you know, fall behind, mm-hmm, he turns the backhoe, turns it on, turns the shovel,
yeah,
towards the train and grips onto it.
Yeah.
It's not good enough. The backhoe is too strong, so it starts to rip apart the train.
Right.
So he has to run along the top of it,
mm-hmm, jump onto the
train that's pulling away, the section of the train that's pulling away.
Yeah.
Completely out of the realm of anything James Bond would ever do.
Oh, come on. He does that every day. He does that before breakfast.
He doesn't. However,
yeah,
there is a right after he does that, the best part of the movie happens.
Well,
he runs, he jumps, tumbles, stands up, straightens his sleeves. And he straightens his sleeve collars there.
I know, that was awesome. I love that.
That was very James Bond.
They start
right?
playing the music.
So it was fantastic. And that's and when you do things that are cool, you can make up for the things that aren't canon or not headcanon or whatever you want to call it.
There's nothing to do with canon in terms of him using a backhoe to stop a train. That's nothing to do with canon. That's just an action sequence.
Yes, it has to do with people's. That sequence was on par with the first Daniel Craig film where he was doing hardcore parkour trying to chase down that guy. People were up in arms because James Bond doesn't do that. James Bond will wait for you in your hotel room. He's not going to go chase you down.
That was a little extreme, but the backhoe thing, that didn't strike me as odd. It's just James Bond.
Well, you're in the outliers because that upset a lot of people. Yeah,
you know how many outrageous things James Bond has done over the past 60 years in movies? I mean,
I've seen Moonraker.
Moonraker, yeah, that stupid one with Halle Berry where he's like surfboarding in the Arctic with there were so many bad James Bond sequences. Him using a backhoe to sort of rip a train apart is like minor. It's not even a blip in terms of the crazy stuff James Bond has done over the past half century.
Well, I agree. There's been a lot of people that did not film James Bond correctly.
In that case, it'd probably be most James Bond movies haven't portrayed him correctly. Who is your favorite James Bond?
Oh, my favorite James Bond, hands down, is Daniel Craig.
Oh, stop it. Come on. Man.
Hands down. Absolutely.
No. Terrible. He's probably the least like James Bond, at least the James Bond from the books.
Shut up. Are you telling me that you prefer Pierce Brosnan?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Oh, you're a fool, Jim. Come on. All your credibility is gone.
Have you read the James Bond books?
I've read two of them. I have not read all of them. I'm not a queer.
Read all of them because Daniel Craig is not James Bond. Daniel Craig reminds me of one of the Russian assassins that James Bond would fight in the books. That's who he reminds me of. He doesn't remind me of James Bond. James Bond, probably the actor who was closest to the James Bond written by Ian Fleming was, what's his name? The one right before Pierce Brosnan. Between Pierce Brosnan and Roger Moore. I can never.
Is this true? You like Remington Steele?
I liked him as James Bond, yes. I like Remington Steele too. That's a good show.
Improby says, soon strip joints will be changed to dressing up joints. That might bother Dillard. What does that mean?
What? Dressing
and
up
joints. And Improby says, Connery is the best James Bond.
Oh, Connery. He was good. But Yeah, Daniel Craig, he doesn't have, he's like, he's lacking the humor that the character has. He's just like a really angry killing machine. And that's not James Bond.
He's guessing Timothy Dalton? Is that who
Thank
you
you, Timothy
like?
Dalton. Thank you. I can never remember his name. Timothy Dalton is the one is the actor who portrayed James Bond the closest to the character that Ian Fleming created. And when those movies first came out, I hated him as James Bond. I thought he was just like lame. And I started reading the books, and I was like, oh my gosh, this guy actually.
I'm sensing a pattern here of you commonly being very wrong about a lot of things.
Well, I'm wrong about some things. I learned that I'm wrong, and I go to
And then in
I
a
try
few
to.
years, when you wise up, you'll learn that I'm right.
No, that's I'm trying to prevent you from making my mistakes. So I'm correcting you now, so you know early that Daniel Craig's a really crappy James Bond. So, although I am looking forward to his new movie, and I did like Skyfall. I thought that was his best movie as James Bond, Skyfall. So, I just wish they would stop pushing the release of his new movie back. I mean, it's been pushed back like 20 times already. Very frustrating.
I understand how frustrated you are, Jim.
You should. And probably ask, what did you think of On Her Majesty's Secret Service? I liked it. I thought it was a good movie. And I mean, I could probably just find out by Googling it, but I always wonder why George, what was his last name? That,
Lazenby?
yeah, George Lazenby. Why he only did
How do you
one?
pronounce it? Lazy?
Lazenby. I don't know how do you pronounce it?
Lazen.
Lazenby? Okay, sorry.
I think. I don't know. I don't know.
I
Don't
use the long
quote me on
AU
anything. I don't
shortly.
know anything about James Bond.
Okay, fine. I'm gonna keep saying it the way I said it. George Lazenby. Or Lazenby? I don't even remember how I said it. But I don't know why he only did one movie, because I thought he did a good job in that first film. So, but that's okay. All right, now I gotta start inking this. Let me see. I will use my brush pen for this. Oh, here it is. Yay. Hopefully I won't mess it up.
How come his arms are so puny?
Shut up.
What did you use photo reference in the mirror or what?
Hey, what?
Got
My arms are,
him.
shut up. My arms are massive.
My arms are massive.
Now you got me all self-conscious. I'm trying to, now I gotta beef up his arm so I don't feel bad. Stupid John Dillard. Right, that's good enough. Oh man, John, you kicked everybody away.
What?
You playing that stupid thing from Ethan's channels?
I
If you don't like my politics, don't buy my books. Where's that from? What music is that?
don't know. It's just called like the coffin dance song.
Oh, really? Okay.
But no, like there's some great beats out there, like newer music that's just fantastic. Like I really love my intro song, the one I got from the probably another movie that you hate, Into the Spider-Verse.
No, I like that movie. That movie is the
It's
first.
not Spider-Man.
Well, it's not supposed to be Spider-Man. It's Into the Spider-Verse about Miles Morales. But that was the first.
Yeah, but the Peter Parker that was in the movie was not the real Spider-Man.
Yeah, I didn't like.
You see how you are? You're so
I'm
terrible.
sorry, but you brought it up. You bring it up, I'm gonna comment on it. I did not like the way they portrayed Peter in the movie. You know, he's no, he's not that lame. I mean,
Improby says Lazenby had been offered a contract for 7 movies. His agent, Ronan O'Reilly, convinced him that the secret agent would be in archaic in the liberated 1970s. No,
his agent was an idiot. Hope he fired him. But as Lazenby, like, you know, was living out of a van by the river.
Oh, Lazenby's a fan. His agent probably dropped him.
Probably. He probably did. But he couldn't get any more work. What a jackass. Man.
What was I saying? Like I was saying, that song from Into the Spider-Verse, the What's Up Danger? Oh my god, it's such a good song.
Yeah, it is. And they used it well in the movie. It was really good, and that film was the first time that I actually found Miles Morales likable. Mm-hmm. I never liked
it. And I liked it, and I liked because I was putting together a compilation for the Buckler, like an intro, right?
Uh-huh.
And I was like, that's exactly what the Buckler is constantly, like, seeking out dangerous situations and trying to be, you know, just the biggest ass in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, yeah, the What's Up Danger, it's, it fits perfect, so.
Yeah.
I had to swipe it.
No, it's good. It's a good intro. I mean, the other one was good too with X.
DMX.
Yeah, DMX.
Rest in peace. All my favorite people are dying, dude. Norm Macdonald is dead.
Oh, man.
Golly,
John, you gotta quit liking so many people.
What a treasure that guy was.
He was great comedian. So it's a shame.
First, Eddie Guerrero.
Eddie Guerrero, who's that?
Eddie Guerrero was a professional wrestler for the WWF.
Okay, I'm not familiar with wrestling, so sorry, John.
Well, I'm assumed that. That's why I explained to you who he was.
Okay, cool. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Very, very entertaining, enigmatic, fantastic performer, Eddie Guerrero.
I gotta move my camera a little so that when I start inking, you guys can still see it. There we go. That's better. Yeah, a lot of people are passing away. Because we're getting older, John.
Not me. I'm in my prime.
My Amazon Prime.
That's another reason I hate Christian Slater. You know, Christian Slater was vying. He was making an attempt to replace Val Kilmer in the Tombstone sequel.
Huh?
Who has the audacity, especially someone with the complete wet mop charisma of Christian Slater, to replace Val Kilmer as Doc Holliday?
Yeah.
Nobody was even asking him. He was like, "I want to do it."
How would that work? He died in the first movie.
Yeah, it was supposed to be, you know, his flashbacks shit. You know,
why wouldn't they just get Val Kilmer?
he stopped working at the time.
Oh, okay. I think that would be a mistake trying to replace him. I mean, it's
Val Kilmer got fat.
Well, wasn't that wasn't that due to his illness?
What?
Was that due to him being sick?
Like in his real life illness or the leukemia
his real life illness. Him being sick in real life was not the
reason. Yeah, that was because of that.
Okay.
But you know, Val Kilmer, you know, famous for being very thin.
Right.
In Tombstone, you know, the Doc Holliday.
Yeah. I think it's better just to like leave. If they couldn't get Val Kilmer, just leave him out of it completely because it's that character is probably the most iconic character in the whole movie, you know? I think it'd be foolish to try to...
You're crazy. Bill Paxton is the best actor in that movie.
Bill Paxton? No.
Morg. He died, though. You know, what are we
going to
do?
Oh, man.
Ryan Cardinal says Christian Slater is a poor man's version of a Jack Nicholson impersonator. Exactly.
Basically, yeah.
That guy, what a blowhard that guy is. What a tryhard, too. That guy wants to, and he calls up people because he wants to be on things that are already successful, and he ruins franchises.
Yeah, like Star Trek.
Yes. And the show Archer.
Oh, he was on Archer? I never watched it.
Right, because Archer's a fantastic show. But then after the show had gone on for maybe, it got a little long in the tooth, you know? It was a little leggy. Christian Slater hopped on there as like an FBI agent or some stupid shit. I mean, Christian Slater just comes in and just ruins shit, you know?
Yeah. It's funny.
He's like, oh, Young Guns was really popular. Can I be in Young Guns Part 2? I'm young.
Yeah, he never really got past the whole Jack Nicholson thing. I haven't watched him in anything in years, so maybe he has gotten better. I'm just not aware of it.
No, I doubt it.
Let's see. Hey, Matt Costin's here, and the Ryan Cardinal's here. Ryan Cardinal has a new book out called Chaos. So if you have not yet checked it out, you should go to Indiegogo and look it up. It's K-A-Y-A-S, Chaos, by
the... It's Caius.
Caius?
Yes, Chaos. What do you...
I thought it was Chaos, like Chaos, but spelled differently.
Is English your native language?
Yes, it is, but, you know, some of these words are confusing.
Caius, a tale of blood and stone.
Caius. Is it Caius? K-A-Y-A-S? Okay, I thought that was pronounced chaos. My mistake, Ryan. I apologize. It probably says, what's Jason smoking today? I don't smoke anything. Maybe that's a problem.
You know what the problem is? Is that you've never actually taken an interest in Caius? So you never seen him on stream talking about it?
Well, no, I've seen the videos, and I love it. I've never seen Ryan on a stream. But I have watched his videos, and for the thing, and it looks really cool. So,
well, at any rate, the Ryan Cardinal is telling you it's all good. Don't worry about it. Illustration by design.
Okay, good. Thank you, Ryan.
How come Colossus has a Frankenstein haircut?
He does. He has like a flat head when he turns into steel. I think. I'm pretty sure he does. But always wonders, like, how come his hair turns into like a solid mass of steel instead of like steel wool? Maybe it does. Maybe it's just... you never thought that?
Well, he's not African American. Why would it be steel wool?
Well, it'd be, you know, it'd be like, you know, little pieces of like steel, you know, instead of like a solid mass of metal.
Like metal shavings or something?
Yeah, like metal shavings. You would think that. I always thought that. It's like, what's up with his hair? How come all of a sudden this turns into like a block of ice?
Easier to draw.
Hey, Matt, how you doing? Good seeing you. I sent you a link if you want to come in. If you don't, that's fine too. I'm looking forward to Matt Costin's book coming out, modded. I have no idea when he's going to when they're going to start the crowdfunding campaign for it, but I will definitely back it. Looks really good. Matt, do you have any idea of when you guys are planning on opening that campaign? It probably says blame Tom Cockrum. Easier to draw Colossus that way. It's Dave Cockrum. And sure, I'll blame him. Even though he's dead. Rip Dave Cockrum. One of the best X-Men artists ever.
Well, you know what he would look like if you tried to put his hair like actual metal? He would look... Remember that TV show Reboot?
Oh, yeah. I love that show. That was a great show.
Okay. There's a... Even more appropriate. You remember there was a band back in my day, anyway. It was probably a whippersnapper band to you.
Uh-huh.
I didn't like. They were called The Offspring.
Menudo? No, I don't remember them. The Offspring? No. Wait, yeah. Maybe. What song do they do?
Well, they do many great songs.
Okay, name's familiar, but I can't. it's not, music's not coming to mind, but anyway, go ahead.
They did a video, a music video, where the guy was, it was like a computer generated kind of guy. I think it was called, Hit That, the music video. And that's what his hair would look like. I will share that with you right now.
Oh boy.
So you can see it.
Okay.
But I won't share audio because that would
don't be strike my channel, John.
Yes, I will not. Okay, so let me see. StreamYards, here we go. Share screen.
Matt Costin says he's about 2/3 of the way through his book. So cool. Very exciting. And is Mata gonna be in color? Matt, I'm curious.
All right, so this is what Colossus's hair would look like if you had to draw it. You ready?
Hold on, one second. Let me. Okay, good.
You see what I mean?
Yeah, and then you use that as like an offensive weapon. That'd be cool. You know, people jump on it. He impales him with his spiky hair. That'd be great.
Mm-hmm.
So. Cool. There we go.
But yeah, The Offspring was one of my favorite bands, and I remember they had came to Riverside here where I live to do a show. Not too long ago, maybe about 3 years ago. And yeah. I was like, oh, I'm going to go, right? But then I started thinking to myself, I'm like a fat old Mexican guy, right?
that's true, but.
And I get that most of their fans are my age because they were famous when I was in, you know, middle school, high school. But at the same time, like, I drove by because I decided not to go. And I drove by, and it was probably a good thing I didn't drive by. Because when I drove by, like, you can tell kind of by the music. Yeah. It's very white boy music. And like,
okay. Liked them, so what does that matter?
Well, you know, there's very turbulent times around here, and when I went there, I drove by the auditorium to kind of see like the crowd of people there for The Offspring, and like it was just a bunch of very drunk, angry white people that were like no shirts on and everything. And I was like, it's probably good I didn't go because I was gonna take my wife too. But.
You're gonna take your wife. Cool.
I do like rock music.
Good.
And I do go to concerts occasionally, and I'll get buck wild. But I think that would probably be a little bit too much.
Gotcha.
Too much stacked against me.
Yeah, I never go to concerts. I mean, I haven't been to a concert on my own, of my own volition, probably since college. I don't know. I just like listening to music at home on my own or in my car. I don't really get anything out of like being with a bunch of people in an auditorium listening to some band I liked when I was in high school.
I get you. I get you. I understand.
Okay.
However, if I ever do get the opportunity, I am going to go to a. Because I hear they might be doing another tour. I might go to an AC/DC concert.
Oh, cool. That'd be cool. Yeah. What's the last concert I went to? I guess it was a concert. I went to see Leon Redbone. You know who he is? No.
Let me look it up.
He's looking it up.
Canadian singer? What the
Great singer. He used to be on Saturday Night Live back in the early 80s.
Is Leon Redbone Frank Zappa? Is the question.
People will always say it's like it's really Frank Zappa with a new persona. It's like he wasn't Frank Zappa. He was a completely different guy. But he sang like sort of like old folksy like type of music. He did Bud Light commercials back in the 80s. But just a really cool singer. And I heard him, I went up to West Palm Beach to listen to one of his concerts. And it was like an outdoor concert. It was cool because there were probably maybe only 100 people there.
And I can imagine this guy looks terrible. Like he's not.
No, he was cool, but he was like, it was such a good concert. It was like a mixture of songs and old stories that he would tell and stuff. And yeah, I'm glad that I went because he died probably about maybe about 5 years later. And I was like, oh man, I'm glad I saw him before he passed away.
Improbi says, will you take the jab to be able to go to a concert?
No, I wouldn't take the jab to go to a concert. No, that's what CDs are for. I can listen to that stuff at home.
See, the thing is, I'm not against getting.
I'm not against it either, but
I am against getting it during this first round. I want to wait for the second round of antibiotics.
I'm against being forced to take it.
Yeah. If they tell me, hey, you know, you got to take this to live, to go to the grocery store.
Yeah, that's no. No,
you know, I got to take it because I got to go get my kid Gerber, you know, but
that's when I start breaking into grocery stores and stealing stuff that I'm not into being forced into doing stuff or you can't eat. We won't let you eat unless you take this medicine that you don't want to take. That's un-American garbage.
I've never been a big fan of America anyway.
What?
Well, here's the thing, Jim. Like my parents, when I was younger and I was getting my parents are they're felons, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So, doing something crazy and stupid, in that household would be like joining the military.
Uh-huh.
Like what the fuck? What the hell would you join the military for? Like that's for white people.
What?
So you're gonna join the military and then you're gonna get shot by somebody. Whatever.
Yeah, that's one of the risks of joining the military.
No, I mean like shot by one of my fellow infantrymen.
Right. Yes.
In my house, it was never like thought of as patriotic. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Like, that wasn't even really a phrase that was used.
Okay.
So like, and the thing is, like, I'm not like them.
Uh-huh.
I'm a little different. I do have a little bit of patriotism in me, but right. For the most part, I'm like, I really don't care. You know,
right.
Like, I don't walk around buying drinks for people that are in the service. You know,
uh-huh. Cause you're cheap.
That's just not me.
You're just cheap.
No, I'll go and buy drinks for a chick. You know, I meet somebody at a bar and we get along real well and we're good friends. Yeah, yeah. Hey, you know what?
The hot female soldier.
No, yeah, man, maybe, I don't know.
See, there you go.
I wouldn't. The point of it is that I wouldn't buy somebody a drink just because they're in the service, you know?
Right, I understand.
Yeah, you get paid for that, you know?
Yeah, I got you.
I'm sorry, you know, you get your benefits, you know?
Uh-huh.
They're already there. You get paid well. You get free medical for life, you know what I mean? Like, get out of my face.
Don't yeah, if you survive.
You need a free drink.
If you survive.
Oh, there's hundreds of them all over the streets. What are you talking about if you survive?
John. Let's see. Matt Cosson, who has no opinion about the jab or anything dealing with social issues or America, says, just say no to the Franken shot. Matt Cosson says the shot is the pandemic. and probably says friendly fire. Ryan Connor says, just remember, friends, this is all part of the mental messaging of the mind. This time it's almost mandatory. Next time it will be by gunshot.
Well, mental massaging. Jimmy, this is plain English.
Did I say messaging? Okay,
yes,
sorry.
Yes, I did.
Massaging. I mistook the A for an E. I apologize. I'm sorry, Mom. Yeah. If you're not willing to speak up for your freedoms now, then
yeah, I don't care. I'll go to Mexico.
No, I'm just saying in general, not you in particular. Then you know, you have no excuse when they go even further next time. So
yeah, I'm not gonna go out there and die for people that are out there harassing other people about you don't have a mask on. I'm not gonna go die for these people. What the hell do I care about these people? You think people are gonna stop being stupid because you go and die for them?
Oh, How's your daughter doing?
Your newest. Great. Yeah, she's How old
is she? Is she a year old yet?
No. She just passed the 8 month mark.
Oh, 8 months. Oh, cool. Awesome. Now, when do kids start talking? I don't have any.
She's making talking noises now. Like, I'll sit there and I'll tell her, you know, say dada, and she'll go da.
Oh, cool.
Da. You know? That's great. She does. She can already say mama. She knows that whenever my wife walks in the room.
See, now you know who has a bigger impact on her.
Of course, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's a girl. Why would a dad have a bigger impact on a girl than a girl?
It'd be funny if she finally started saying your name. She said, Buckler. Buckler.
Oh, my heart would explode. I would love her all the more.
That's cool. How many children do you have, John?
Just two.
Two? Okay. And how old's the older one?
She is... Three years.
Oh, okay.
Very cool. 4 months.
Wow, that's great. Very exciting.
Unlike some fathers, I do know my kid's birth date. I still forget my mom's birth date.
Yeah, I get confused sometimes with my mom's birthday just because her birthday is the day. I guess it's the day after her anniversary. They got married like the day before my mom's birthday. So I would always forget like which day is which. So.
See, the thing is my brother has a kid and she was born on the same date that my dad passed away.
Oh, wow.
And everybody's like, oh, how sweet. And I was like, that's super morbid. How is that sweet?
Yeah. It gets a little. Yeah. Happy birthday. It's like, oh, yeah, my dad died. Yeah. Yeah, it was odd. My father passed away the same date that my father-in-law, my wife's father, passed away. They both passed away on the same date. Separated by, I think, like 5 years. I always found that interesting.
That is strange.
Yeah.
And people do normally die around the fall, too. That's also strange.
Really?
Yeah, I noticed that most people in my family, the last maybe 6 or 7 funerals I've been to have all been in the fall.
Really?
Yeah, like November, October.
Hmm.
And I actually do have to go to a funeral this month.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Wow. We haven't set the date yet, though. I don't know when it's going to be.
Hmm.
Nobody close to me, though, so who cares?
Yeah, fortunately, you know, everyone in my family is fairly healthy. My mom's doing good. She's in her 80s. And, you know, everyone who's still around is still in pretty good health. So,
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to prompt your life story or anything.
Oh, that's okay. I won't give you my life story, just part of it. let's see. What? Ooh, Ryan Cardinal's talking about cult programming 101. And probably asking when will the uprising begin? And, let's see.
When will the uprising begin, Jim? And what will prompt you? Because you're part of the sleeping giant.
What will prompt me?
You're the one that claims, you just wait until they go too far, and then they're going to get it.
Well, the thing is that if it ever comes to that point, I won't let people know. I'll be doing stuff on the down low against the...
Are you going to tell your wife you're on the down low?
No, no. Well, if I did, I wouldn't be on a down low, would I? I'm not talking about that down low. I'm talking about the other down low.
Proby says two children that Dillard knows about.
Two what that you know about?
Two kids. That I have two kids.
Oh. Hmm.
Yeah. No, that's not. I'm not a man whore. I'm a faithful guy.
Yeah. I think he's talking about before you got married.
I don't cheat on my wife.
Before you got married.
Before I got married, I was a virgin.
Oh, dang, John Dillard. Oh, my gosh. My, my respect for you just rose a little. My goodness.
Well, there you go.
Very good, John Dillard. You're not as skeezy as you would like people to think you are.
I mean, I like to have life experiences.
Yeah, I know, but
you to a point, you know.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. Pretty awesome.
You're hanging around at a pool party, people get drunk. You might pull out a titty. You might even suck on it. You know? but you don't go too far.
Man.
You don't cross that line, Jim. I'm a cross Christian that man. Line.
Yeah, I did not want a knock on my door, you know, in my 60s with some 20-year-old standing there or 30-year-old saying, "Hey, I'm your son." So I tried to make sure that there were no
I'd be like, "So you're over 18, right?" Yeah, cool. Come on, come hang out. As long as I don't got to pay no child support, come and hang out. Let's go fishing.
Yeah.
I'm so excited, dude. I'm going fishing. I'm like a kid in a candy store. I'm wriggling in my seat thinking about this fishing trip.
Yeah.
I can't get over it. I'm going to meet some people over there. I'm going to go with my wife, my kids. We're going to go to the beach. Oh,
cool.
And we're going to spend the day there. And then come sundown, we're going to move everything to move the party over to the pier and go pier fishing for a while.
That's nice.
And then we're going to have some of her friends from college that she still is in contact with. They're going to come and join us. Also, my cousin Ray.
Oh, that's nice. Very cool.
His son, Gabriel. I'm sorry, Michael, not Gabriel. He was calling me the other week and he was like, "Oh, I'm super excited because like whenever they go fishing, it's usually with me."
Yeah.
Because there's not a lot of people in my family that like going fishing. Mm-hmm. So it's usually us when we go.
Yeah.
Like we go so often together that we actually have like group camping gear that we store at my house. Like he'll bring stuff over. Like, "I just bought this new tent here. Put it over there."
Okay. Cool.
Cause that's pretty much when I go camping, it's usually with Ray. And so like, we're going to meet Ray over there too. He's going to come drive down. Cause he lives closer to Newport Beach. He lives over in like East LA area, Pico Rivera. So he's going to meet us over there. And then her friends are going to meet us over.
Yeah. That's nice. Yeah. I haven't been pure fishing probably since high school. I used to go with my friends and we get up at like 5 in the morning and then go to Deerfield Beach Pier and fish. I don't have the patience for it. I go to fish and it's like, I want to catch fish. So if I don't catch fish, I'm annoyed, you know? It's like, I don't find it relaxing. I find it like stressful in the sense that it's like, it's not working and, you know, I'm getting up early in the morning and nothing's happening. And so, you know, I kind of gave it up after, I think I did it several times, like over the course of like a summer or something. Mm-hmm. And after that, I was just like, nah, you know, there wasn't enough, weren't enough benefits coming out of all my efforts.
I get you. No, if you don't actually enjoy just being out there and fishing, like, yeah, I could understand how fishing would be completely tedious.
Yeah, you have to just enjoy just being out there. And I'm very much an indoor cat. I don't like being outside. I don't like camping. And I've been camping a number of times, and each time it's just been like, just not fun. Between the mosquito, I live in South Florida, which is basically the Everglades. You know, once you get into the woods. So it's just mosquitoes and bugs and, so it's just, it's not fun to me.
Yeah, I don't like, because I get mosquitoes here too. And I don't like them to the point where I don't even go out without putting on a bunch of, mosquito repellent.
Yeah.
I even if I get one, like between the knuckles or on the wrist or something, oh my God, I'm miserable for a week, you know?
Right, yeah.
So I take preventative measures when it comes to that stuff. But, I really do enjoy just being out there and sitting on, like I sit on the pier And we usually will set up a you know, if we don't catch anything, you know, when we first get there, we'll put a, like a soda can in the bucket and tie a fishing string to it. So when people come by and look in your bucket, you pull the string and the soda can jumps up and they get scared. And then, you know, usually I'll rig up like a sabiki line, like a bunch of little tiny hooks, and I'll catch some like little tiny like jack smelt or tiny, tiny mackerel.
Right.
And then hook those up to my bigger pole and then just toss it out there and kind of bait and wait, you know, like see if I catch anything substantial.
Yeah.
But I like to just sit there and chit chat with my friend or, you know, my wife, or hold the kid and, you know, bounce around the knee kind of deal, and walk around the pier with her and look at all the buckets of people's fish and, oh, look what they caught. Oh, cool. You know,
that's neat. That sounds like fun.
Yeah, we head on over to the bottom of the pier, get some hot chocolate and donut, come back up. I love being out there.
Yeah, that's great.
So, like, even if I don't catch fish, I'm cool. I would prefer to catch fish, though.
Right.
But usually, I mean, and there's cheats, right? Like, there's fish that you can catch even if you don't try. Like, if you hook up a little sabiki rig and you put a little – and you actually bait them – like a sabiki rig, if you don't know, it's like a – oh, here, I'll draw you a picture. It'll be easier. Let me go here. Let me share. Oops, the wrong one. Let me go here. Share my screen. There we go. Okay, so this is what it is. Like, here's your pole, right? Here's your fishing pole. Whoop, 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 whoop. And what it is on your line, you put a weight at the bottom.
Yeah.
And then there's about six or seven little lines that come off like this.
Right.
On this rig. And each one will have a little piece of like feather that's like shiny to mimic like a little fish. Right. And it'll also have a hook on it.
Okay.
If you use these and you also because you can use these just like this and just jig it up and down,
right?
You know, on the pier, and you'll get little fish will catch onto it. Yeah. But if you put bait on it, like a little piece of mackerel or a little piece of shrimp or something on each of these hooks, like you're guaranteed to catch something at the pier. Now, it's not going to be a big fish you're going to be able to take home and show your friends and take a picture, but you'll have fun. Little kids will have fun looking at the fish on the hook, you know, flopping around and all that stuff.
Yeah. Cool.
It's usually it's just for catching bait, essentially.
Yeah, I got you. Awesome.
So it's kind of like when you take the kids fishing for bluegill, like it's you got a good chance that you're going to catch something and the kids are going to have fun.
Yeah. Oh, Jeff Potts is back from a soda run.
Finally, fucking Jeff.
I'm waiting for hours, Jeff Potts.
Standing outside the grocery store pitching woo is what he was doing.
But actually it is about 4:30 now, so I gotta kind of get going. It's only gonna be a 2-hour stream, so but haven't done much on here, unfortunately. I'm getting there, and I've inked the head. I guess I'll finish it tomorrow. Shoot.
Well, it looks very clean, very professional, Jim.
Yeah, I think that's part of the problem. It's like I'm taking too long for these drawings. I'm like, oh, I'm getting into it. It's like, oh yeah, that I want to mess it up. But I'll probably just keep drawing it off stream. And then I will possibly be back tomorrow, either tomorrow or Saturday. I'll be live streaming again. So, but John, I want to thank you for hanging out with me, keeping me company.
And it's always a pleasure to hang out with you, Jim. You're a hell of a guy.
Thanks. I appreciate it. You're pretty cool too. I want to thank everybody who has been watching, even Jeff Potts, who left for 90% of the stream to get soda. Thanks, Jeff Potts. But I want to thank Improbby and Ryan Cardino with his new book, Chaos. And check it out on Indiegogo, KAYAS.
It's Chaos, Blood from a Turnip.
Or Kayak or something like that. It's on Indiegogo. He still has about 20 some odd days left, and it looks really cool. He has a really awesome animated video. Go check that out. Actually, I'm going to play it right now.
Nice. So you're going to get struck by Ryan Cardinal, though.
Oh, well. Ryan Cardinal, I'm going to play your video. Don't strike me. Let's see here.
I got his video right here.
Yeah, grab it, John. Push it up there. Yeah. God, you're funny. Hold on.
Hurry up with that video.
Give me a second. All right.
This guy's taking forever for this video. What are you doing?
Leave me alone.
What?
There we go. Share screen. Let's see. Chrome tab. Is that it? There we go.
That's it. Is that a thing? It says, is Jason going to start twerking or daggering?
What's daggering?
I can just imagine what daggering would be. God, that's nasty.
Is that showing up?
Wait, hold on. Real tiny. It's showing up tiny.
I know. Hold on.
Fix this now.
Hold on. Make this full screen. That should do that. And let me
look at the
unmute that. Play.
Hi, it's the story of Blood and Stone. Issues 1 and 2 go live on Indiegogo September 7th. Be sure to get your hands on these action-packed adventure comics and don't miss out.
A fury of blows. That chicken. Some great action in that chicken.
Go back.
Fantastic.
It's awesome. I mean, that's a fantastic animated video. So
Jeff Potts says, I think I threw up in my mouth a little. I think maybe participating in some daggering might help that.
Ooh. Yeah. No. Hold on. Something's going on here. Boink. There we go. That's done. All right. Well, John, thanks for watching. Thanks for hanging out with me. I appreciate it. Thanks for, for everything, I guess. Everybody else, thanks for watching. I appreciate it. I will be back later on. I'll keep working on this drawing, and I will talk to you guys later, okay? You take care. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Say bye, John.
Goodbye.
Nice.